truthfulness of that song as much as we ought to. All we really need is Jesus. God knows our human nature. God knows that we are creatures that need creature comforts. And even Jesus acknowledged that our Heavenly Father knows that we have need of all these things. And I think, even for myself, that I feel like I stand in need of a lot more than I really do, when in actuality, all we really need is Jesus. I want to read a couple of verses in Hebrews chapter 6 tonight. Hebrews chapter 6, beginning at verse 1. The theme in the book of Hebrews is better things. The Hebrew writer, writing here, and he draws powerful illustrations from the Old Testament. He begins the writing of this book by saying, God, who at sundry times and divers manners spake in times past unto our fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken to us by something better, spoken unto us by his dear Son. And that certainly is a better thing, you know, than just merely hearing the word by some man. The Son of God, the Savior of the world, God incarnate, came here and spoke to mortal men. Wow, what a wonderful blessing that must have been. To see with the natural eye and hear with the natural ear, as John wrote in 1 John, that which we have seen and heard and even felt, declare we unto you. And what a great blessing that was. And so the entire theme of this book is about better things. And certainly Jesus was a much better witness, better preacher, prophet than any earthly man. Talks about the priesthood of Aaron. It also talks about a better priesthood in Jesus Christ, who offered a better sacrifice than those blood sacrifices in the Old Testament. And Christ was certainly a wonderful, perfect sacrifice for the sins of lost humanity. Here in Hebrews chapter 6, the Hebrew writer begins, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection. Not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works, and of faith toward God, of the doctrine of baptisms, and of laying on of hands, and of the resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. This we will do, if God permit. I'm going to stop reading there at verse 3. My thought for just a few minutes tonight is, let us go on to perfection. Let us go on to perfection. I remember being at the hospital when Bo Smith was newly born. I arrived at the hospital. Chrissy had already given birth. And I watched the nurse behind the glass in the nursery measure Bo's little body. You know, I took a little tape measure and wrapped around his belly, wrapped it around his head, and stretched it from head to toe. And they measured him, they weighed him, and all that. Taking down this basic information about this newborn child's life. And of course, as a newborn infant, you know, we expect those children to grow. And so those dimensions and those weights and things are recorded, and they're watched for a few days to make sure that everything proceeds as it should be, to make sure this young child is healthy. They do that for newborn babies, and I made an illustration of this before. As young children, you know, we've all stood in the doorway, and parents have measured our height and that sort of thing. As a young child, you know, we sometimes stretch a little bit because we want to be just as tall as we can possibly be. We want to grow up. I told Carl morning that if he doesn't quit growing, he's soon going to be as tall as I am. This young fellow's really, really shooting up. And we can watch these young children grow. And in human growth, I mean, it's a normal thing. The process of maturation is a wonderful thing. You know, in some ways, you know, we progress as we grow from childhood to our adolescent years and into adult years. And we finally reach our peak performance years somewhere in adulthood. And that's a wonderful thing to see. But at the same time, it's a very sad thing to see, because in a very short time then, the grass withers and the flower fades, and, well, we know what the end result of that is. Job said, man that is born of a woman is but a few days and full of trouble. He comes forth like a flower and is cut down. And life here, certainly, that James describes it as a vapor that appears for a short while and then vanishes away. Folks, time in general, we know, time in general is short and is full of troubles and difficulties of every kind. Paul said in Romans that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now. And our lives are filled with numerous trials and difficulties of every kind, and there is precious little time for profitable things. You know, it seems like in some ways we spend so much time wrestling with the trials and difficulties of this present life, and it seems like there is so precious little time for us to spend doing the most important things in life. C.S. Lewis made the observation that you know, we as mortal men, we spend all of our time perpetually pursuing the rainbow's end. He said we don't spend as much time as we want to doing the things that we want to do or the things that we ought to do, but we're pursuing these frivolous, less valuable things in life. Jesus in his ministry made the observation that people often strain at gnats and swallow camels. You know, and how true is that? You know, we get so caught up in things of so little consequence. You know, it is like straining at gnats, and we'll turn around and swallow a camel if we're not careful. We have an expression in our time that, you know, we know what it is to make mountains out of molehills. We know what it is to make much ado about nothing. And it seems like that is a great part of the human experience, that we have much to do about nothing. The Apostle Paul, in his ministry, I think, in his life, his personal life, perhaps Paul was a sports enthusiast. He was a sports enthusiast, or he at least read his audience well and understood that probably most of them were sports enthusiasts. And you know, all of you know that I am a sports enthusiast. I thought that would get a little laugh. Paul employed athletic illustrations in his ministry, I'm sure because he understood that his people would understand what he was talking about when he used them. For example, he said, I'm pressing toward the mark for the prize. And I think that we can all see in that expression the illustration of a runner that's just, you know, straining every muscle and reaching, just leaning as far forward as he possibly can and straining every muscle to achieve the victory, to win the prize. He said, I press toward the mark for the prize. But he was talking about the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. And as we look at that illustration, you and I, we're to understand that, you know, Paul was pursuing spiritual things, something far more valuable than any earthly pursuit, a race more important than any earthly race, any athletic race possibly, and that he was straining with everything that was in him to win that prize. He said in another place, he said, I have fought a good fight. I've kept the faith. I've finished my course. And there again, you know, he was not unfamiliar with the Olympic Games and the wrestling matches, the fighting matches that those early athletes had. And he said, I have fought a good fight. But he was talking about spiritual things and how that he had been fighting the good fight of faith. And he said, know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize. And he said, so run that you might obtain it. Again, he said in the Hebrew letter, Perhaps it was Paul. I believe it probably was. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. He said, let us lay aside every weight. That he began with, wherefore seeing that we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. Perhaps he'd been to the Colosseum in Rome and witnessed the great athletic spectacles there and the huge crowd of people that would be gathered around. And he said, brethren, wherefore seeing that we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. And he's talking about the crowd, and he was talking about the athletic event, the race. And he was talking, and the important part of it was the goal, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith. Now here in the book of Hebrews, in the few verses that I read to you, the author of Hebrews is not employing an athletic illustration here, but rather an academic one. When he said, therefore leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfection. And the idea here is moving from infancy to adulthood, moving from a novice student to a learned scholar. In education, as in our natural lives, it's natural that we would grow, that we would progress, that we would start at some point, and that as we study and as we learn, that we would become more and more knowledgeable about those things that we're studying and learning. And rather than straining at gnats, you know, that we'd be stretching and striving for greater knowledge and understanding about those spiritual things. Peter, in his writing, and I've referred to these before, he specifically mentions two important things in our spiritual life that all of us as Christians ought to do. And he said, first of all, he said, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. And I believe what he was talking about there is for you and I as Christians to make room in our hearts and in our lives for God. I don't know how you feel, but very often I feel like I've got a pretty full plate of things that I have to do all of the time. I've mentioned, you know, sometimes I feel like a fireman when the alarm clock goes off and I slide down the pole and I run off into the day, you know, doing what it is that I feel like I have to do, putting out fires or whatever it is, you know. And I'm sure it's that way with you a lot of times. Nick, my wife and I, when we moved to the South, we thought, well, this is going to be great. We're going to move to the South where everything is just kind of slow and easy. You know, get down there with those laid-back Southerners. I remember an experience I had in Kingsport several years ago. We were still living up north. We had been to Georgia. We were on our way back home. It was Christmas time. We had some Christmas shopping to do. We stopped in Kingsport to visit some family there. We thought we'd go to the shopping mall in Kingsport and do a little Christmas shopping. And these Northerners who were so used to this fast-paced bam-bam-bam-bam kind of lifestyle, we're in there, you know, we're zigzagging in and around the mall and in this store and in this store and trying to get through the store and get all this stuff done. And these people would be standing at the checkout counter talking about Aunt Susie and, you know, Uncle Wim and you know, come on, folks, let's get moving here. We've got things to do and places to go. So we thought when we moved down here in the South that we're going to get caught up in this slow, laid-back kind of lifestyle. It didn't happen. You know, our lives are full. And Peter said that we need to sanctify God in our heart. We need to literally make room in our heart and in our lives for God. And, you know, I believe, folks, the devil is so pleased with all the stuff that we've got crammed into our lives and pleased with all the business and the hustle and bustle of our physical lives, because when we're worn out physically, it's next to impossible to do anything much for God in a spiritual way. Peter said we need to make room for God in our life. To sanctify means to set apart. It means to make holy. God is already holy, so we can't make God holy. What it means is to clear out some clutter in our heart, in our lives, and make room there for God. God warned Israel, when you go into the Holy Land and you inherit all of this stuff that you didn't work for, houses and fields and cities and all of these things, he said, I want you to beware that you don't forget me. When you've got all of this other stuff, to take care of and warn them, don't forget me. And so Peter said, one thing that we need to do as Christians, we need to make room for God in our life. And second of all, he said, what we need to do is we need to be ready to give an answer to every man that would ask you a reason for the hope that is in you. Be ready always. In other words, you know, having been saved, and I spoke about Philip this morning and trying to imagine how Philip felt when he went to Nathanael to tell him, we found the Messiah. We found the one that the Scripture has been telling us about. We have to imagine the joy and the enthusiasm in his heart as he was sharing with his friend the most important thing that he'd ever known in his life. We found him. Come and see him for yourself. That's the kind of readiness that Peter was talking about, that we should be ready on every occasion to share with people what we know about God. He wasn't saying we need to be ready to pull out our doctorate degree, you know, or whip out a Bible and the big long sermon outline and preach the gospel to folks, but just be ready to tell them what we know about Christ. That he's the Son of God, the Savior of the world, and that he saved me, you know, on a Thursday night in 1969, convicted me of my sins and saved my soul. And, you know, that's that wonderful song that David had to sing when God brought him out of that horrible pit. Amen. We need to know that song and learn that song. It would be our favorite song and be ready on every occasion to share that wonderful news, the good news, the gospel news with people that they are saved by the grace of God. The Hebrew writer said here, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, was he suggesting that, you know, we don't need to really pay that much attention to that? Heavens no. But when we look at this in its context, he was telling these Hebrew Christians that right now, for the time in your life, you all ought to be teachers. You ought to be grounded and studied in the faith and be teachers of this. You know, and that we should progress, that we should go on from spiritual infancy to grow in our Christian life to spiritual manhood, to perfection. You know, to be ready, just like Peter said, to be ready on every occasion to be the witness that God would have us to be. And he said, leaving the doctrines of the principles of Christ. These are the rudiments of the faith, the very fundamentals of the faith. Repentance and faith and conviction and salvation and baptism and eternal security. Those are the things that are the very foundation of our faith as Christians. But we should grow in the faith. We should graduate from those things and go on, as the Hebrew writer said, to new heights spiritually. I believe the Lord used an illustration that as believers in Christ, that we would be like a householder that would bring out of his treasures, things new and old. You know, and every day that we should be experiencing new things in the Lord, or as simply as Peter experienced on the Sea of Galilee, when Jesus came walking on the waters, Peter said, Lord, bid me to come to you. You know, what he was seeing Jesus do, Peter wanted to do himself. And the Lord simply said, come on, Peter. Step out of the boat. Just step out of the boat. And he did. Brothers and sisters, as Christians, that's what we need to do, is step out of the boat and walk on the waters of faith. God challenges us. The Lord challenges us. I'm going to strangle, I think. He challenges us in the book of Malachi to put him to the test. Put him to the test with tithing. Oh, there's that awful word. Tithing. But you know, God challenges us to put God to the test with our money. You know, God knows where to hit us, where it hurts, doesn't it? God knows what our Achilles heel is. God knows what's important to us. And he said, I want you to prove me with what's important to you. Just try me. You know, see if I will open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing on you, if you'll bring all your tithes and offerings and put them in the storehouse. He said, just put me to the test. I dare you to. It's a spiritual dare for us to do that. And we're challenged to step out of the boat and walk by faith and put God to the test with a tithing. And to live up to the label that we have put on ourselves. Christian. We're Christians tonight, aren't we? Christ-like. When Jesus saw, or when Peter saw Jesus walking on the water, what did he want to do? He wanted to walk on the water. Who wouldn't? Who wouldn't want to experience that? And the Lord told his disciples, the works that you see me do, he said, greater works than these shall you do. And that one's always perplexed me. Greater in how? And in what way? Greater in number? Greater in glory? Surely not. But he told them, you know, greater works than these shall you do. You know, and the Lord challenges us. We're Christians, and we like that name. We want to be recognized as being Christ-like. And we certainly ought to be imitators of Christ. We're Baptists. I think we all are, aren't we? Man, I don't know if we've got anybody in here that's a Methodist or Presbyterian, but for the most part, we're Baptists. You know, and we should live up to that label. You know, but to do that, we need to know what Baptists are, and we need to understand these principal doctrines, these foundational doctrines of our faith, of repentance, of faith, of conviction, and eternal security, and believers' baptism. You know, all those things. But then we need to go on from there to perfection, to spiritual maturity. And we're missionaries, aren't we? You know, I can't get out of my mind what Trevor spoke about Wednesday night when he said, people ask us, are you all going to become missionaries? We're all missionaries, aren't we? At least that's what we're supposed to be. Jesus told his disciples, you're my witnesses. You know, I want you to wait here in Jerusalem just for a little while. You know, as newborn Christians, as new, you know, initiated disciples in the faith, we have to tarry for a little while to get grounded in the faith. But from there, he said, you're going to be witnesses of me here in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and on the uttermost parts of the earth. We're missionaries. You know, Trevor and Kayla spoke Wednesday night about, you know, their mission trip to South Africa, and I've got to tell you, I was impressed, you know, and inspired by their dedication, by their surrender to God. I wonder if any of us here tonight, any one of us here tonight, ever thinks that we would ever have to spend any of our time going to a foreign country to be a witness for the Lord. Has it ever occurred to you that God might expect that of you? And if it hasn't occurred to you, why not? I've wondered for a long time, you know, if many of the ministers that I know, if they ever expect it, ever have to leave Carroll County or Benton County or Henderson County to serve the Lord. I'm not from here. I've wondered so many times, why did God bring me here? And I still wonder about it, but I'm so glad that he did. You know, I grew up in Toledo, Ohio, and I wonder sometimes why I'm not there when there's such a huge need for preachers like myself and Brother Adam there. The home church that I grew up in, it's dying because there are no preachers there. And I don't know of any preacher that has it in the back of their mind that they would ever have to leave home to go to a place like Toledo, Ohio, to serve the Lord. I was taken by Trevor and Kayla's surrender to God and their sacrifice. Maybe they took vacation time to go to South Africa for a couple weeks. But that's a sacrifice, isn't it? When most of us would want to go to Myrtle Beach, you know, or Gatlinburg. These two young people chose to go to South Africa and spend their time sharing with people the love of God and their service. I believe that's what the Hebrew writer was talking about when he said, let us go on to perfection. God bless you, my prayer. I hope that all of us will have a greater understanding of our Christian duty, surrender and sacrifice and service to God.